Are you sure you don't mind listening to this?
Oompa, loompa, doopity-doo. I've got another puzzle for you. Oompa, loompa, doopity-dee. If you are wise, you'll listen to me. Who do you play when your deal is up? Rat, pampered and spoiled like a Siamese cat. Breaking the kids is a lion nut. Shame to know exactly who's to blame. The mother and the father.
We need to make some rules.
Why?
We don't use our real names. We don't say what schools are from.
We leave out all the details, you know? Just gives us a bit more freedom.
Keeps it impersonal.
Yeah. I'll use William.
I'll be Eva.
Emily.
How do you know you're not some middle-aged man trying to get off chatting up two teenage girls?
How do I know you're not some frustrated housewife trying to take advantage of an innocent altar boy?
Are you an altar boy?
No, I'm not an altar boy. I'm not officially middle-aged for another, what, 20 years?
Are you religious?
You know, I'd not rather talk about religion. You either do believe or you don't. End of discussion.
Who made you big brother?
Well, we're all around 15 years old. And we're all middle-class kids. Probably. I think we all know each other's views on boring stuff like religion.
Oh right, so what's mine?
You're disillusioned by the official church. But you remain spiritual. And you've made your own little religion on the idea that everyone should be good to each other.
Bastard.
Well, am I right?
Well, that's not the point.
I'm sorry, it's a cliche. We're all cliches.
Yeah, all people can be placed in our boxes like that.
They can.
So, what are you?
Pain in the arse.
Apart from that?
I'm a cynic. Quite an angry cynic.
Very attractive.
Not really interested in being attractive. Why should I be?
Because attractive people go further.
Yeah, I think I read that article in one of my mum's magazines.
What I'm saying is people see a cynic as a black hole, they're nothing. While someone who may be attractive or charming, well, they're at the very centre of things, changing times and manipulating events. What are you but a bad smart?
Thanks very much.
You know what I mean.
So you think I'm maybe handy?
You certainly sound that way.
Well, that's the name of the room, isn't it? Cork's bloody opinionated. I'm at the age, sorry, we're all at the age, where being a teenager should mean something. To me, it's not all about making friends, going bowling, sitting at McDonald's and bumming cigarettes, or talking about the latest busted LP. It's a waste of fucking time. Now's the time to be a pain in the ass and step away from the others. We're teenagers. That used to mean something. Think about it. In the last, what, 20 years? What teenagers done besides punks? Nothing.
And punks didn't even last long, did they?
Yeah, but that's not the point. They were angry and they showed that.
My mother was a punk. We got a photograph from 1976 and she's got a cold sore on her face the size of a tennis ball.
It was dirty work being a punk.
Yeah, you see, teenagers nowadays wouldn't go that far before cracking out their cleansers.
Definitely.
But you know what I mean, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I went on an anti-war march for an hour or so, and I felt really good and I found empowered, but it was just so small. In the great big scheme of my life, it was just 1 hour saying I'd leave or something. I suppose the rest of the time we're just sleepwalking through our days, waiting for something to happen, instead of making something happen. It would be so great to accomplish something. To have a cause.
William wants to assassinate J.K. Rowling.
I was only joking.
We spoke about it for an hour last week in the Harry Potter chat room.
Yeah, it's not her person, it's the idea of her life, what she stands for.
And what's that?
Well, they see us as a threat.
Who do?
Adults.
It's a conspiracy theory.
No, it's like adults support these writers to type up these cutesy tales of fantasy so that kids have these warped ideas of what life's really about.
So, J.K. Rowling's the High Priestess?
Yeah, she's the enemy. Well, no, not her personally, the idea of her. You know, if I kill the idea of her without hurting her, I'll do it tomorrow.
You're a lunatic.
I just want to do something big and important. Frustrating.
Would you ever really kill anything?
No, any idiot can kill them. Where's the glory in that?
Oh, you meant to say that each life is sacred.
Exactly.
Well, I think that's crap. There are people in this life that it's just wasted on. Terrorists, dictators, racists. They took all the goodness out of living.
Love, William.
Shut up.
I think William just wants to have a call. He wants to see that cause through. He wants to make a big statement.
Exactly, a big statement. Thanks, Eve.
Eva.
Right, whatever.
Is anyone there? Are people still awake? Is this room really called Cork's Bloody Opinionated?
Wait, mate, before you say anything, we don't use our real names. Right. Names of schools, any details. You know, we know we're from the same area and that's enough to tie us together.
Okay, I'll be Jim.
And Jim, I'm William.
Hey Jim, I'm Eva.
Emily.
So what happens here? I don't know these places. What goes on?
Pee discussion, chit chat, mostly bullshit.
We're looking for a cause. William here wants to make a big statement.
We're all a bit frustrated.
If you have any causes handy, feel free.
Well, can we talk about our problems here?
Oh God.
Have you got any problems, Jim?
Well, yeah, I do actually.
Yeah, no, big problems.
Well, I think so. They're big to me,
yeah,
anyway.
Yeah, and you want us to listen to him, give you some advice?
Jesus, William!
Look, are you still there? Fine, I'll move on to somewhere else if you really want.
Might be a bit of fun. Jim?
Yeah?
We're here to help you, mate.
So I've been bullied all the way through primary and now in secondary school. I'm small, skinny, so it goes with the territory. You expect it. But I've got bigger worries, deeper worries. And that's hard to explain. And very recently, I've started to feel, what's the point in anything that we do? But not in a moaning, teenage-y sort of way.
Yeah, your depression's definitely not put on.
No, I'm not someone who keeps an altar to Kurt Cobain or anything like that. I actually can't stand the violence. The point is, I don't need that type of music to feed my depression. I can happily do it all by myself.
Obviously not happily, Jim.
Yeah, happily's the wrong word. But you all know what I mean.
What does depression feel like?
Oh, Jesus, Emily, it feels great. What do you think?
No, I know. I just want to offer such, Jim.
Well, Jim?
It feels like the whole world has turned into butter. Everything has the consistency of butter. And your insides and your heart, well, they just sort of ache. And it's like you're clogged up with about 5 slices of pizza. It's exactly like that.
Depression's like pizza.
Oh, Jesus. Shut up, Emily.
I was only repeating.
No, I'm sorry. It's really difficult to explain.
Yeah, I'll probably leave out the food comparisons.
Schizophrenics often say they feel like they make salad. Sorry, Jim.
Nah, it's okay.
You sound sweet. Do you have a girlfriend?
Jesus, Emily, you're supposed to give Jim advice?
I did have a girlfriend. I don't now.
I just wanted to know if you're a day more close to you. There's no one in your family to talk to, so I thought maybe understanding a girlfriend would help.
Look, if you've been listening to Jim for, what, the last hour? You wouldn't ask him that. He doesn't have our normal teenage-y problems. And not problems that can be solved like that. By a quick grope outside the chip shop.
He's different.
Look, yeah, he might love a girlfriend right now, but that can't happen. Because at the moment, he's just dealing with getting up in the morning and facing another one of his shitty days.
Hey, I'm not that bad.
Maybe think before you speak, Emily.
Piss off.
No, it's just bullshit. You're showing me some hen sand prince.
I'm not like that.
You're a selfish bitch.
Jesus, all I said was...
Look, Jim has the courage to come into here and talk about all his pathetic shit. All you're asked to do is imagine there are other people in the world that are different from you.
You have no idea what I'm like.
Like a comment like that, like Jim could be cured by the heart of a good girl.
I didn't mean it.
Sorry about this shit.
No, really, it's fine.
We've all got a good impression of the type of girl you are, Emily.
Fuck off.
Living in a little suburban bubble, small group of girlfriends who sneak over copies of Bliss after music lessons.
Girls are all called Sarah, right? Sarah Jane, Sarah Ann, Sarah Marie, Sarah Louise.
The hairband brigade and your... deck shoes and pink shirts.
What's the worst that ever happened to you? Scuffed your chinos at the park. The night your dad couldn't pick you up from pizza, so he had to go home on the bus.
Or when your pony had to be put down because your big fat preppy arse was buckling its back.
I had anorexia.
So what?
Weekend anorexia, was it? Bursting out your chinos, that's a lose a few pounds.
Shithead.
Anorexia's a status symbol for your type of girl. You ain't your 6 months anorexia like it's a badge of honour. Thinks it gives you an edge. And it makes you a cliche. And that's why when someone talks to you about depression, you can bat it aside with shit like, if only you had a girlfriend. If like you drone on, you'd be singing that song Cheer Up Charlie.
What? Charlie and the Chocolate Factory?
Oh, Jesus, I hate that fucking film. Get out of here, Emily.
I agree with William. We want people who are here for Jim.
I am here for Jim.
No, people who get the cause.
What cause?
What? He's your cause now.
Right, listen. We're here for Jim 24/7, 100%, okay? He's feeling cut up over something and we're here to give him advice, understood?
Put simply...
Piss off.
Look, maybe she didn't mean what you think.
There's no need to defend her, Jim. Look, Eva, can we step out a second?
Yeah, of course.
Look, we're all he has right now. Let's let him speak, you know? See how far we'll go, mess him up a bit.
Okay.
Jim?
Yeah?
Start talking, mate.
Right. So I'm 6 years old. My three brothers and my mum, they're going away for the weekend. For a treat. Or something. My mum says, your father is to stay behind to look after you. So we have a chance to bond, I suppose. My dad asked me what I want to do, and being six, I said, please come and visit the penguins at the zoo. I was going through this mad penguin obsession. So we got the bus. We got the bus. And on the way, he starts talking to me about what a really fat baby I was. We got there, and we watched the penguins. It was the perfect childhood day. My dad, then let's go on my hand. And he says he'll bring me back a chalk ice. It's been an hour since he left. But I'm not worrying, not yet. I'm content with the penguins. I finally have to leave. I get on the same bus, all by myself. I sit near the driver, so I feel safer. I get home, grab the key from under the mat, and enter the house. I run a bath. Because Dad, he would have liked that. I drink my evening milk. I eat my evening biscuits. I put his favourite programme on while I wait for his return. God, it's getting late now. And dark. The house, it feels too big. So I get my quilt, I go to the bathroom and I lock the door. And I wait there. by myself. Until he comes back. I realise he's not gonna come back. I realise that he's never coming back. I wait there for 2 days.
Shopping every day, yeah. Take it back the next break. You see the more you cry, the more you risk your eyes. And I'm just looking, I'm not dying. I'm just
the horse riding, sailing classes,
etc, etc, etc.
At the age of 4, you had your first realisation that the people on your estate laugh at your brothers for their aggressive social climbing.
And the people at the sailing club laugh at you for renting the cheapest boats and wearing the shittiest clothes.
Your first feelings of anxiety is that you, when you realise that you're living in a family hated by everyone, and you are one of them.
So you decide to stay indoors. But of course, being the youngest brother to brothers built on the rugby field, they adopt you to their playpen. And let you on their punch bag. You know we all hate you.
Such an idiot.
You're the reason Dad left.
Loser.
Yeah, we spoke to Mum, she says you're an accident.
At the age of 5, one of your brothers pushes your head into the water in the bath, while the others count out the seconds.
1, 2, 3. It's your brother that saves your life. Through resuscitation.
I need to slap you for pissing in the bath in the first place. You slowly come to realise that the outside of your house is a much more hostile environment than inside.
So, finally, you decide to go outside and play with the other children. Oh, only to realise that the bonds of friendship have already been formed. And there's no room for little tubby toddler with a weird penguin obsession.
You're alone.
But you do find a friend in...
Timmy.
Ah, little Timmy Timmons.
Yeah.
A tiny six-year-old with severe bronchial problems who has to push an oxygen canister behind him while all the other children play road football.
You're watching Timmy's mother slap phlegm out of his chronic lungs.
No!
Into a plastic bag.
No!
Watch your lips at the age of 6. You have your thoughts on your own mortality.
One momentous day, your father leaves you at the zoo. Leaving your family in the shit.
Your mother is forced into getting her first job. She finds work in a petrol station, ending all the dreams of the posh life and throwing her into a depression used only by you bit.
Gin and tonic, the tonic being...
Valium.
Your best friend, Timmy, dies.
No!
But not by the tragic weakening of his lungs in the middle of the night, no.
By a speeding Ford Mondeo which fastens his trailing oxygen canister and leaves Timmy walking zombie-like to the estate, while all the other children shout,
"Star boy!"
On the day of Timmy's funeral, you take your first Valium. You are aged 8.
8 and a half.
Sorry, 8.
You try and make contact with your dad by giving out flyers around your neighbourhood.
If you see him,
but to no avail, as vandals in the local neighbourhood deface these flyers so that they resemble Osama bin Laden. Because of this, you're briefly investigated by police authorities.
Did you do anything? Again, your mother slaps you.
Slap!
You try and make friends by ingratiating yourself to whatever they want you to be.
But again, to no avail.
hide yourself in books of the occult, which leads to a period of bedwetting.
Wait, is that important?
Definitely.
You briefly turn to religion and take part in a passion play. But you then realise that you hate Jesus Christ, only slightly more than your mother, the Virgin Mary.
At the age of 13, you watch your first porn, which creates more of a distance between you and those girls you will never get to touch.
You hate yourself, and you stop communicating with other people entirely.
The next 2 years is a sad cocktail of homemade beer, the odd Valium and the odd shot of whiskey.
Nights begin to take on a pattern of aggressive self-analysis and blame, until one night, you're speaking to an American bloke on the internet who's planned to kill himself. His unfortunate name is Chad.
Like Chad and the others in the suicide club, you reach a point of recognition. You're searching for a purpose.
A purpose. Right, Jim?
A purpose? Fuck. 15 years! It's both embarrassing and depressing.
You know, if it wasn't such a tragic life, it'd be quite a funny story.
For some reason, Jim, you never seem to have been given a chance. You're always the one that gets burned.
Yeah, but why me?
You can't take responsibility for what other people think you do.
Right.
Why people have done this to you isn't something you have control over.
Yeah.
Why me is a pointless question.
Okay, sorry.
Stupidity.
What are you feeling right now? That's what's important. Focus on that.
But try and think what's positive.
Just shut up, Emily.
Just shut up! Idiots!
Look, focus your anger. And channel that into something that'll get these bastards back.
But how? How do you mean?
How would you get back at your mum for all those years of neglect? All those years she treated you like nothing.
I've screamed at her so many times. But it doesn't help. And it doesn't make me feel any better.
So?
I suppose. I mean, lately I've been thinking about if she came into my room in the morning, and if I'd done something. Like I've cut my wrists! Or taken an overdose! Or just something! But I could imagine her face.
She'd be crushed. The guilt would kill her.
Yeah, it would. But I don't know if I'm ready to do that. Not yet.
Look, Jim.
Yeah.
Me and Eva can't really imagine what your life's actually been like.
No.
It just sounds so sad. Without hope, probably. But listen, we've been giving up our time for the last few nights listening to you.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Really, I appreciate it.
No, it's okay. But listen, I want you to do one thing for me before you go to sleep tonight, okay?
Yeah, sure.
I want you to ask yourself two questions. Have you got a pen to write down?
Yeah, go on.
Right. Can I ever put my shit past to rest? Can I ever feel any different to how I'm feeling right now? From 15 onwards, you'll live your life in these different phases. People will sum you up into boxes until they put you in your final box and shove you in the ground, guaranteed. Only a few brave teenagers speak out of them. Only a few brave souls make a stand. Teenagers like you.
Like me.
Imagine this, Jim. Imagine all those lost teenagers you'd be speaking out for if you killed yourself publicly.
Brilliant, well.
How do you mean?
I was thinking that how you've been neglected by your close family and friends. It allows you to see clearer than us. It's like your depression represents the average plight of a normal teenager. It's like a metaphor.
It would be very brave.
Brave?
Very romantic.
Romantic.
Sexy, even.
Sexy? But do it in public. Look, I'm not too sure about that.
Maybe it'd be easy in your room, over the internet.
Yeah, it sort of seems right that you remain alone.
Yeah. But it's stronger.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, yeah, I suppose. Lately, I don't like going out in public so much. I mean, it'd be easier here. I've been lying awake all night. And I started to think about all those thousands of teenagers who kill themselves every year. Someone will be killing themselves right now, while hundreds of others will have it planned out. Look, these people who are doing this are sick. They're very sick. Others are doing it because they're sad. They're alone, or they're frightened. There are so many reasons to do it. It's 2 o'clock in the morning, and my mum's outside hoovering the stairs and the landing. Tonight, my three idiot brothers call me a freak. Why? For not wanting brown sauce on my quiche! I better go, guys. Thanks a lot.
Idiots!
Sweet dreams.